Good afternoon and welcome. We're so pleased that you can join us for this special event. I would ask you, if you haven't already, to please turn off any cell phones or electronic devices you have for the duration of this. And please join me in welcoming Associate Justice of the United States Supreme Court, Antonin Scalia, and the Duane and Kelly Roberts Dean of the School of Law, Ken Starr.
This is the book. If you don't have it, why don't you have it? But not to worry, all is forgiven. Go get it. It is a great book. We'll be talking about a whole variety of things today, but this is Making Your Case, and we're using the book in the appellate advocacy class, and the justice is kindly going to be teaching that class, or is it co-teaching? But he's going to be in our class.
I hope co-teaching. I'm not going to do your work for you.
I had to get leave.
You get paid the big bucks for doing this. I don't care.
Yeah, where is the executive vice president of the university? This is a wonderful book, Making Your Case, and any person, even if he or she is not in law school or practicing law, can make use of this because we all make our case day in and day out, regardless of the venue. Justice Antonin Scalia was here in 1990. You should have seen the reaction of the students. I know on good authority from Dean Ron Phillips that the student evaluations were off the charts, and you'll soon see why that is. And that was a long time ago.
A long time ago.
He has since been back to our London program two summers ago and taught a seminar in separation of powers. So, again, join me in saying welcome to Justice Antonin Scalia. Justice Scalia.
The dean is too kind. The dean has not adverted to the fact that we were colleagues for how many years, Ken? A couple of years, anyway.
Until you graduated.
Till I graduated.
I got left behind.
Till I got kicked upstairs. Yeah, we sat on the D.C. Circuit together, so that's why we are good friends of long standing.
A great court and a great colleague. Well, you've gone on to glory, and your alma mater, the Harvard Law School, now has, and I saw it recently, your portrait. And your portrait at the Harvard Law School Library is situated between the portrait of Justice Louis Brandeis and Justice Felix Frankfurter.
New Yorkers, both. I think that's why they put me there. I'm another New Yorker.
I thought Brandeis was from Kentucky, but he's from New York.
I don't think so. Was he?
You know. The judge is always right, even when the judge is wrong. Both those justices, even though they had different approaches, are viewed as great justices. They're kind of in the Supreme Court Hall of Fame. What makes, in your view, for a great justice?
Let me talk about the portrait first, okay?
Good.
It's a tradition in the court that your law clerks pony up the money to get your portrait painted, which is then hung in the court after you retire or die. And the whole thing is arranged by the Supreme Court Historical Society. Many years ago, like 15, maybe 20 years ago, I've been on the court 23 years, Leon Silberman, who was the president of the Supreme Court Historical Society, came and he told me, I think it's maybe time that you, let us approach your law clerks and raise some money for your portrait. And I said, no, these kids, they've only been out of here for a few years. Wait till they make some money. You shouldn't hit them up this early, So. So he allowed that, although he said what was really a very wise thing to me. Anybody who's going to have his portrait painted. Remember this. Leon said to me, well, okay, but you're not getting any prettier. So they finally did it last year, and it's a good job. But it can't hang in the court until I die, so they have to find some place to put it, and Harvard agreed to hold it. Now, what was your question? No, I remember the question.
Great justices.
Great justices. Well, you know, I guess there are different great justices for different reasons. I mean, if you want to talk about the justice who contributed most to our whole structure of not just constitutional law, but of the way in which the court operates, it has to be John Marshall, right? If you want to talk about the most influential justice in terms of influencing the flow of the law, if you want to talk about the most influential in the 20th century, it was Bill Brennan, who was always, you know, pulling the court in the direction of that he favored, and very successfully. If you want to talk about a justice who was the best writer and usually on the right side of things, made you proud of the court, even when the court was wrong, there was a dissent by this wonderful justice that made you feel good about the court. That would be Robert Jackson, whose seat I occupy. I'm in the same chair that he occupied. And he's probably, among modern justices, my hero. I think very, very highly of him. And he didn't go to Pepperdine. Indeed, he didn't even go to law school. I shouldn't say that, I suppose.
And barely went to college. In fact, I don't think he went to college.
He didn't. Yeah. He didn't get a college degree anyway. He's really self-educated. Remarkable. Yeah.
A poor farm kid from upstate New York.
Yeah.
You can join the conversation. We're going to ask you to do it more formally. So there'll be no microphones, but you've got cards before you. This is the style that we call the National Press Club style. So write or print. Do people do cursive these days, Justice Scalia?
None of my grandchildren do. What do they spend their time doing in grammar school? I mean, I must have spent a third of grammar school learning how to write. They don't write cursive anymore. They really don't. It's all printed. You know, happy birthday, Grandpa, all printed.
So you can send a question that's either printed or in cursive, and they'll be collected in about 15 minutes or so. So as the conversation unfolds, please join in written form. Chief Justice John Marshall, who you mentioned, said that it's emphatically the province of the Judicial Department to say what the law is. About a decade later, in McCulloch versus Maryland, he said, "We must never forget that it is a constitution that we are expounding." In those days, the Marshall Court was pretty unanimous. In fact, they were virtually always unanimous. Since we've been at the business, I'm glad this is such a funny question.
No,
since the court, shall I continue or not? They want to hear you, not me. But we've been at the business of constitutional interpretation for over two centuries. And yet, if anything, the divisions seem to get even deeper. Why the deep divisions in the court in terms of interpreting the Constitution?
All right. Well, listen, I was laughing about John Marshall. You say the court was unanimous because Marshall would not put up with dissents. I mean, he was really, indeed, he would write opinions that he didn't believe in just to get the whole court on it. And things changed after a while, you know. You want to hear this? This is interesting.
Yeah.
Okay.
They apparently want to hear it.
The Supreme Court used to function, when I said John Marshall, you know, not only developed the structure of our constitutional law, but also the manner in which the court operates. The Supreme Court used to write opinions the way the English high courts did. That is, each justice wrote his own opinion. And the bar, in order to figure out what the holding of the case was, you had to read five opinions and divide by five. You know, fine, whatever the common thread was. It was John Marshall who established the unique manner of opinion writing that exists at the Supreme Court, in which there is one opinion for the court, but it's not, as it is in Europe, an anonymous, you know, formulary opinion, blah, 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 no life to it, you know. It's a real live person who signs it, and then the other justices can join that. That was John Marshall's creation. And Thomas Jefferson was furious with it because by the time the Federalists were no longer in the majority, Marshall's court was still coming out with these Federalist opinions, and Jefferson was furious, and he wrote to one of his appointees to the court, Johnson from South Carolina, "Why don't you write your own opinion? You know, these hiding opinions. We don't know who to impeach," said Jefferson. Every justice ought to write his own opinion. Anyway, that's why his opinions were unanimous, and eventually it broke down, and there began to be dissents. Now, why are there so many dissents today? I mean, I don't mind there being dissents. On an issue of law, let's say an issue of statutory construction, where we all agree on what the principles are, you can disagree on how much weight to give to each aspect of it. You know, this canon of interpretation versus another canon, and they all have some application. I can see disagreeing, but what is different about what's been happening for the last 30 years or so is that we disagree on the fundamentals. We disagree on what we think we're doing when we interpret the Constitution. I mean, that's pretty fundamental. What do you think the object of the game is? There are those, only two of us for sure on the current court, who are originalists and think that the object of the exercise is to figure out what it was the American people agreed to as an exception from the principle of democracy. When they adopted this exception, the First Amendment, Fifth Amendment, whatever, what did they think they were doing? On the other hand, there are other, when I mentioned Billy Brennan, there's a school of thought that Bill Brennan championed, which is that the Constitution changes. It doesn't necessarily mean what it meant when the people adopted it. So, although the death penalty was surely constitutional when it was in 1791, when the Cruel and Unusual Punishments Clause was adopted by the people, it may be unconstitutional today because times have changed, we're a different society, and all the Constitution is meant to do is to be an embodiment of the most profoundly held principles of the current society, and the Supreme Court will pronounce what those most profoundly held principles are. So, you know, you have two profoundly different takes on what we think we're doing. And, you know, in some areas, I let a thousand flowers bloom, but I don't think this is something to be proud of, that we don't know what, for sure, what we think we're doing. And I have to say, I'm not the new kid on the block. I mean, originalism was orthodoxy 50 years ago. Everybody thought that the Constitution, read Joseph Story's commentaries on the Constitution. He didn't think the Constitution morphed from decade to decade. It was a rock that the society was anchored to. The new version, what is new, is the living Constitution notion that it morphs and... If it does morph, and I'm going to tie it into the quote from Marshall, if it is that kind of a document, it's not like an ordinary statute. It's just an invitation to apply the deeply held principles of modern society. Why should it be up to the court? Marshall said it is assuredly the province of the court to say what the law is, because the court was composed of lawyers. There's nothing in the Constitution that says the Supreme Court shall be the last word on the constitutionality of legislation. It doesn't say that. But since the Constitution is a law, and since it's always been the function of lawyers and of judges to reconcile seemingly conflicting laws, if you have two statutes that conflict, you try to reconcile them. If you can't, the more recent one prevails, having implicitly repealed the older one. But, says Marshall, in the case of a super statute, such as the... What is that?
You're making a baby cry.
What is that?
you're Your approach to constitutional interpretation is making that baby cry. Just kidding. As you were saying.
The modern constitutions of Europe, the Europeans are used to mock us for our system of judicial review and then have adopted it after World War II. They say that the Supreme Court, the Supreme Constitutional Court, will determine the meaning of the Constitution and whether legislation conforms to it. Our Constitution doesn't say that. And the only reason we get in the business is because it's lawyers' work. It's what lawyers and judges have always done, reconcile statutes, reconcile a super statute with an ordinary statute. If you can't mesh them somehow, the super statute prevails. It's lawyers' work. Now, if it isn't lawyers' work, if indeed what the Constitution means is, as we say in our Eighth Amendment jurisprudence, the Cruel and Unusual Punishments Clause, our cases in that field say that what constitutes cruel and unusual punishment is not static, but it changes from age to comport with, this is a quote, the evolving standards of decency that mark the progress of a maturing society. Yeah, lovely. Every day and every way we get better and better. which was not the frame of mind possessed by the framers of a Bill of Rights. Why did they do the Bill of Rights? Because they worried that a future generation would not be as virtuous as they were, or as wise as they were. But nonetheless, that's what our Eighth Amendment jurisprudence, and that's why I've sat with now, four colleagues who thought the death penalty is unconstitutional, even though it's mentioned in the Constitution. I mean, no person shall be deprived of life, liberty, or property. What do you think they're talking about? But to come to the final point, if you believe that the Constitution is this empty bottle into which each generation is to pour its most profoundly held beliefs, then Marshall's wrong. It isn't lawyer's work. The meaning of the Constitution should be determined by the legislature, which is what happens in England. They know what the evolving standards of decency are. Do you think I know? I don't know what they are. I'm afraid to ask what they are. But the House of Representatives knows. So if that's your vision of what the Constitution is, whatever Congress says is okay. Because they know better than I what the most profoundly held beliefs of the American people are. But that's where we are. You have two radically different visions of what we're supposed to be doing when we interpret the Constitution. On the one hand, there are those who say, and some of the court's opinions have said it in so many words, in the last analysis, it's up to us. It really said it that way in the last analysis, it's up to us. Show of hands, five, yeah? You like this one? Versus, no, our job is to figure out what the American people thought they were doing when they adopted whatever it is, the First Amendment, the Fourth Amendment, and so forth. What did they think they were enshrining in the Constitution? To what extent did they think they were reducing democracy, which is what a Bill of Rights does?
At times, the members of the court use the same methodology, or at least seem to be using the same kinds of materials, but come to diametrically opposed views. And the very now renowned case involving the right to bear arms and the interpretation of the Second Amendment, the court divided 5-4. You wrote a very detailed opinion for the majority to the effect that the Second Amendment does in fact carry with it the individual right to bear arms and not tethered to, in the modern sense, the duties of the National Guard. So it's an individual right. Four justices disagreed with that, so obviously you were in the majority. It's always better to be in the majority, isn't it? Usually.
Mostly, yeah.
Mostly.
Except when the majority is wrong.
Well, in this instance, all of the writing justices either wrote or they joined opinions that used historical materials that related back to the founding. So how do the, because we have a number of persons who are not in law school here, how do the American people then come to understand what it is that the justices are doing when they are willing to take the same set of materials, but they come to different views?
Well, you don't think that the four were real originalists, do you? You don't really think that if they had looked at the history and found it came out the way they didn't like, they wouldn't have abandoned the history. I never did understand why the dissenters in the Second Amendment case chose to fight the battle on my turf, which was the original meaning. And what can I tell you? Read the opinions. I think we answer every single one of the points raised by the dissent. The dissent does not answer nearly the points that we raise. For example, yeah.
That was hard work.
It was hard work. It was hard work. For example, we point out that during the entire 19th century, there was only one legal commentator who thought that the Second Amendment conferred nothing but the right to join a militia. Only one. And he admitted that everybody else disagreed with him. Now, you know, that just one of many points not replied to. So what can I tell you? I didn't think it was wasn't a fair fight, really.
And thus you won.
Well, read it. You got to read it. But you see, most people won't take the pain to read it. It's a lengthy, lengthy opinion. So if you kick up enough dust, you can say, well, you know, on the other hand, four thought it was, and four and five thought it wasn't. No, you can't make your judgments like that. If you're serious about making a judgment, you have to read the case closely and decide which of the various opinions is closest to the truth.
Let's turn to a recent opinion of the court. You did not author the opinion, but again, the court was divided 5-4. Now, this is a case involving the Fourth Amendment exclusionary rule, so the exclusion of evidence seized in violation of the Fourth Amendment. And in this particular case, this chap in Alabama, Benny Herring, had his pickup truck impounded. He comes to the lot in the sheriff's department to retrieve, not to get his truck, but to retrieve some stuff out of the truck. And a very astute investigator in this local jurisdiction says, ah, there's old Benny, and he's always brushing up against the law. Let's check to see whether there's an outstanding arrest warrant for him. There wasn't in this particular county, but the investigator was so astute that he said, we'll call the adjacent county. They call the adjacent county, and sure enough, there is an outstanding arrest warrant from that county for Benny. Well, within 10 minutes, Benny is in custody, has been searched, and a weapon is found, a couple of other things, but the key is that he was a convicted felon in possession of a weapon. But during that 10-minute period, so things move very fast in Alabama, during that 10-minute period, the county calls back and says, oops, that arrest warrant was no longer valid. We made a housekeeping error.
Forgot to take it off our computer.
And the issue before the Supreme Court was, should the Fourth Amendment exclusionary rule apply to exclude from evidence the gun, the weapon, inasmuch as because there was no probable cause for the arrest and no outstanding valid arrest warrant, everyone agreed it was an illegal search. The court divided over what is the reach of the exclusionary rule and what are its purposes. The majority speaking through the Chief Justice held that the exclusionary rule did not apply in these circumstances for a variety of reasons, and the dissenters, through the voice of Justice Ginsburg, said it should apply in these circumstances. Once again, now here we're in a judge-made rule, but interpreting the Fourth Amendment and the need, as the court has said, to vindicate the interests of the Fourth Amendment and so forth. What is it that's dividing the justices in that kind of case?
Yeah, well, it really isn't interpreting the Fourth Amendment, of course. I mean, it's there was a violation of the Fourth Amendment, undoubtedly. It was an unreasonable search and seizure since they didn't have an arrest warrant. What they were interpreting is what ought to be the consequences of a violation of the Fourth Amendment. Should you, when you conduct an unreasonable search and seizure and find a bloody axe, do you have to let the axe murderer go because the constable made a mistake? Now, there are those who have been opposed to the exclusionary rule from the outset, because that's what it says. Whenever the policeman makes a mistake, you let the criminal go, even though you have him dead to rights and he's a murderer or whatever. You got to let him go. That evidence cannot be introduced. That is not contained in the Fourth Amendment at all. And when we adopted it, we didn't pretend that this had been the common law rule, because it hadn't been. Now, we could adopt that rule for federal courts just by reason of our supervisory authority over federal courts, but we imposed that rule on state courts as well. And the only basis for doing that was the Fourth Amendment, right? So the basic difference, look at the five, look at the four. The five probably don't think that the exclusionary rule is a very good idea anyway. And the four do. Things have changed a lot since we first adopted the exclusionary rule. There were not professional police forces the way they are now. They're much more professional. You have a record, and if you violated the Fourth Amendment, it'll go down in your record. You won't be promoted as often. It's a different world than it was when we first adopted that. And the court has not been willing to extend it to what you might call good faith mistakes. And this was a good faith mistake. He thought he was acting properly. He violated the Fourth Amendment, but he didn't realize he was and didn't intend to. So we let it in. That's all.
That's all. You look so thoughtful, I thought there was another
sentence. I'm always thinking. What
can I do? The questions are very thoughtful. For those of you whose questions are not being asked, I am doing only the slightest filter. If you're asking about the status of a pending case, I'm choosing not to ask that. I can understand your eagerness and interest to have some insights. You heard it first at Pepperdine, but wait till the opinion comes out. But nice try. Here's a question, and there are several in this vein. Which of your opinions are you most proud of because of its impact on the court's jurisprudence?
Well, I haven't had that many triumphs in bringing the court back to an originalist view of the Constitution. But one area where I did was the Confrontation Clause. It's in the Sixth Amendment, and it says that in all criminal prosecutions, the accused shall enjoy the right to be confronted with the witnesses against him, the so-called right of confrontation. This goes all the way back to the English Bill of Rights, and the English got really mad when Sir Walter Raleigh was tried for treason. There was introduced at his trial an affidavit by an alleged co-conspirator who was in France, saying that Raleigh was indeed a traitor. And Raleigh insisted that in the common law you cannot bring in this hearsay. Bring the witness before me in the tribunal, and he will recant what he says in that affidavit. The court did not allow it, and Raleigh's head was chopped off. And it was well remembered by the English. And that was the genesis of our confrontation clause. There's no doubt what it means. It means that the witnesses against you have to appear in court and say, yes, he did it. You cannot bring in a witness who says, Joe told me that he did it. You bring in Joe. Otherwise, it's hearsay. And that's not permitted. Okay. About 25 years ago, in a case called, what was it? Reynolds? Never mind the case.
When you know it, I get called on in class and I'm not prepared.
The Supreme Court, I think the opinion was written by Rehnquist, who was no originalist, and very much law and order. That opinion held that in order to comport with the confrontation clause, all that is necessary is that the hearsay introduced must bear, quote, indicia of reliability. And the lower courts were going nuts over, you know, what does that mean? What are indicia of reliability? Well, I wrote an opinion for the court that overruled whatever that case was. You don't have to remember the name anymore. It's been overruled. That's why I've erased it from my consciousness.
Off the hook. And I'm not going to get any discretionary points, that's for sure.
And we said, made a lot of sense really, that the only indicium of reliability that can satisfy the confrontation clause is confrontation, which seems to be quite so obvious. It's such a simple-minded case, I don't know why I should be so proud of it. But actually, it did overrule what I had thought to be a real distortion of the Constitution. And it makes a good point that do not think that those who believe in an evolving Constitution do not think they're always going to be creating new freedoms and new liberties. No, it's a two-way street. They'll be taking away some of your old freedoms and some of your old liberties as well. And that's what happened with the Confrontation Clause. So we brought it back to what it should have been. And I was very proud of that. And that also answers the libel that originalists are really just law and order conservatives and they like originalism because it always leads in a conservative direction. It doesn't. It doesn't. Sometimes it brings back the liberties that later decisions have eliminated improperly.
This question from a non-lawyer, but he says, when I look at the U.S. Constitution, I see a document that severely restricts what the federal government is allowed to do. However, when I hear the people's representatives, the lawyers and the pundits, it seems as if the federal government can do just about anything. What happened? Let the record show the witness is contemplating. Great question.
Well, you know, who? The framers were very wise and intelligent men. What feature of the Constitution do you think it was which protected so-called states' rights? Which prevented the federal government from doing whatever the heck it wanted. What feature of the Constitution do you think would have enforced the 10th Amendment, which says that those powers not given to the federal government remain with the states and with the people? The ordinary student, perhaps not a Pepperdine student, but the ordinary student would say, the Supreme Court! Which is, of course, quite wrong. Why would the Supreme Court... I'm a Fed. I have no interest in limiting federal. Federal power is my power. I'm appointed by a federal president, confirmed by a federal Senate. You expect me to ride herd on the federal government against the states? No way. You'll get a quirky Supreme Court now and then that might read the Constitution the way it's written. But... But by and large, don't look to the Supreme Court to protect the state. The protection for the states in the original Constitution was the fact that until we adopted the 17th Amendment in 1913, the states owned the Senate. The Senate was not elected by the people of the states. It was elected by the state governments. That was the central mechanism that preserved the states. And we threw that away in a burst of populism, and you can trace the decline of so-called states' rights from that point, with Supreme Court opinions interpreting the Commerce Clause more and more broadly, and so forth. And you know, we are very much a federal republic. Our citizens, when you know, students come to the court, I tell them that you know, in one sense, we're the most important court in the country because we decide federal law and that trumps everything else. But if you want to ask what court is most important in your life and in the life of your family, it's not my court, it's your state Supreme Court. 95% of the laws that we live under are state laws. And whatever the state Supreme Court says, that's it. I have no say about that. So we are very much still a federal republic, but we are a federal republic at sufferance. If the Congress wants to sweep it away, it can do pretty much whatever it wants. It's a very sad observation, but I think it's true. And worst comes to worst, they replace the Supreme Court, right? If indeed we don't always act in the interests of the federal government versus the states, they could expand the court and put people in who will dance to their tune. Now, the only mechanism was the control of the Senate. That's gone. So don't mess with the Constitution. That's the lesson.
Well, speaking of the Senate, one very intriguing question. In the nation's history, only Justice Chase was impeached but was not removed. Come on now, shouldn't at least one justice in our history have been removed? There is more. Assuming the answer, the question is, which one? And then question number three, and why?
Not me. We put them all on a big wheel and, you know, spin the wheel. there's nobody I have such antagonism towards that. There's a wonderful exchange of Law Review articles between Frank Easterbrook, who was then a faculty member at Chicago, and David Curry, who was another faculty member, and I think Curry started it, writing a Law Review article entitled "The Most Insignificant Justice." And he went, David had studied, he read the U.S. reports from, you know, number one to the current one. And I forget who his candidate was, but then Easterbrook responded. He came up with a justice who had not written any opinion the whole time he was on the court, okay? And Easterbrook replied, you know, that's nothing. You want to get somebody who did write an opinion, but who was terrible. It was a good exchange. Anyway, it's one of those two. One of the ones.
Oh, no, I'm still unprepared. I don't know which one those were. Your relationship with Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg is well recognized as being very cordial. How can our country get back to cordial relations between political rivals?
Oh, they're very cordial. When they slip the knife in, they say nothing personal. They really do. They do. They say it all the time. I want you to know there's nothing personal in this. I've destroyed your reputation. But there's nothing personal. It's just politics. I don't know. But certainly in our... In our political branches, there is a lot more hostility than there used to be, and I think it's partly because The parties are more, the two political parties are more polar than they used to be. You know, there used to be a fair number of conservative Democrats and a fair number of liberal Republicans. And that, for one reason or another, has changed. And, you know, the left has tended to dominate the Democratic Party. And I shouldn't talk about politics, but I think that's what underlies the whole thing. And I also think that it was important that we had political parties that were not that much different from each other. Because one of the great things about the American political system, and you only realize it if you know something about the European political systems, one of the great things about ours is that you can throw the rascals out. You know, every 4 years or every 8 years, you can't do that in Italy. You can't throw the rascals out. You know, it's a system that doesn't have two parties. There are multiple parties. So if you vote to throw out the current coalition, they'll just put together a new coalition. And it'll be the same crowd in there. They'll just have different ministries. A wonderful thing about America is you can throw the rascals out. Now, you know, that's not a very dangerous thing to do if the new rascals are not that much different from the old rascals. But if it really is this pendulum swing from one side to the other, that's probably bad for the system. So I think one can long for the old days when the parties were not quite as polar.
We have a number of questions going to relationships within the court or the dynamics in the court. Could you describe what happens at the conference, as the gathering of the justices is called?
Yeah, well, I can do it because the former Chief Justice, Bill Rehnquist, wrote a book about the court in which he described it, so I'm not coughing up any secrets about the court that are not already out. Conference is a misnomer, Rehnquist said, and he's quite right. It is not... If you have the image of these nine wise Solons who know the answers to life's most profound question, should there be a right to abortion and therefore is? Should there be and therefore is a right to suicide? Should there be and therefore is a right to homosexual conduct, same-sex marriage? If that's your image of these wise men and women gathering to discuss these profound philosophical questions, cast it aside. When I first came on the court, we were issuing 150 full dress opinions per term. We would sit for 2 weeks in a row. We'd sit Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. We would hear four cases each day, two in the morning, two in the afternoon. We would have a conference to discuss Monday's four cases Wednesday afternoon. On Friday morning, we would discuss eight cases from Tuesday and from Wednesday. We would also vote on cert petitions that had accumulated that week. We would do those eight cases and the cert petitions and be done by lunch. So, you know, this is not a great grappling of... It is essentially each justice stating, this is how I see the case and this is how I vote. It's not a waste of time because you take notes so that if you are unfortunate enough to be assigned the opinion, you can know how to write it in such a way that at least four other people will agree with you, okay? So it's not a waste of time, but it is not an exercise in persuading one another. It really isn't that. It's just a statement of views. The minds are made up when they come in, and very, very rarely does anybody's mind change.
Switching to the position of the court and threats to independence, Chief Justice Roberts often implores Congress for cost of living pay increases, which have not been granted for years. Would you reflect for a moment on the threats as you see them to the independence of the federal judiciary?
Well, I don't know. It's a threat to the independent, and I wouldn't call it a threat to the independent. What I worry the most people do not understand how and why our federal judiciary is different from the judiciary in other countries of the world. It is prestigious to be a judge in the Anglo-Saxon system, because judges were generally, at least for the major courts, you selected the most successful practitioner, and it was a capstone of an excellent legal career to be made a judge on the Second Circuit or even on the district court in the Southern District. Compare that to the European system. In the European system, when you graduate from the university, you pick your career. You can go into the Foreign Service, you can go into private practice of law if you like, or you can go into the judiciary. You pick it right out of the university. And you get made a baby judge in a little insignificant court. And if you keep your nose clean and don't make waves, you are promoted by a judicial council up through the system. I never realized when the French used to refer to the American system of judicial review of legislation, they used to refer to it as le gouvernement des juges, government by the judges. I never realized how contemptuous that was until I understood what a French juge was. He was the most blinkered bureaucrat you could imagine. He has had his snout in the public trough his whole life. Whereas an American judge at a significant court has not only not been hired by the government, he's been suing the government much of his life, or defending his clients against criminal prosecutions. Different mindset, totally different mindset. And what I worry about is that we are drifting towards the continental system. One of the things that causes that is the salary. I think I've had something like 6 law clerks who have been made federal judges. 3 of them have left, because they had kids who needed braces and were coming up for college age. They just couldn't do it. That's one fact. It's not the only factor. Numerosity is something else. As the federal government enacts more and more laws and puts nickel-dime drug laws into the federal courts. I mean, that's not the kind of thing federal courts used to do. That's basic criminal law stuff that the state courts used to do. So what has happened? The big explosion in the number of federal judges. When I was in law school, there were 67 federal court of appeals judges, 2/3 as many as senators. It was prestigious to be a court of appeals judge. Now it's over 300, I mm-hmm. think, and district courts even less so. So that's another factor. It's just less prestigious than it used to be. And that's largely a factor of Congress enacting vast new quantities of federal legislation. And also my court inventing all sorts of new constitutional rights that have to come through the federal courts. But I worry. If I have one worry for the federal judiciary, that is it. That we are becoming like the Europeans, and we will have a bureaucratic federal judiciary. Now, Congress would love that. You don't think they like an independent federal judiciary. They would like a judiciary that, jumps to their snap of the fingers. But that's not what we've been up to now, and I fear that that's where we're heading. When I was on the Court of Appeals, the summer I was nominated, my daughter Catherine spent a couple of weeks with a family of her German teacher in high school, a little town in Germany. And she's there the first night, and they ask her what her father does. And she says, well, my father is a professor of law at the University of Chicago. Oh, ausgezeichnet. I mean, they are really impressed. And she continues very proudly, but he is going to become a federal court of appeals judge. Your faces drop. What has this man done to disgrace himself? He had been a law professor, and he's going to be a judge. And whenever I traveled in Europe, I was not Judge Scalia. I was Professor Scalia. That's where we're headed, though.
Here are a number of questions about oral argument, so let me draw from the well from several of them. Thank you so much for coming to Pepperdine. When Justice Thomas was here recently, he suggested that the court could benefit from more silence during arguments.
Nah.
Perhaps this isn't necessarily it. What do you think is really behind there, and would there be benefit to his speaking up more? P.S., sorry about the printing.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if the court would benefit from silence, but I think that Clarence would benefit from talking up now and then. Yeah, but man, you know, I've told him that. He knows that's my view. He makes it easy for the people who try to dismiss him as, you know, a cipher. He's not a cipher. He's a very, very smart man and has written wonderful opinions. But for some, he just doesn't think we should answer questions and ask questions. And I think he's just making it easy for those who hate him to marginalize him. But that's his view. I don't want to sit there. You know, if you don't ask questions, what's going to happen for half an hour? The lawyer is going to get up and regurgitate his brief. I've read his blessed brief. I don't want to hear it again, orally, you know. You first read the book, then you hear the book on tape. I mean, I really, that's what'll happen. And the whole purpose of oral argument is to probe and test what seem to you the weaknesses in the brief. And you can do a lot of that in half an hour. But if nobody asked any questions, and lawyers don't like it either. You think a lawyer likes to get up before a cold bench? I argued only one case before the Supreme Court, before I became a judge. And I got two questions the whole time from Byron White. And it's terrible. You look from face to face. Come on, you guys, help me out. Am I talking about something you're already persuaded about? Should I go on to something else? Nothing. They'd look at you, you know? Well, Ken will tell you. Effective counsel welcome questions. It's the only time you know for sure you're not wasting your time is when you're answering a question. You are actually responding to a concern of at least one of these judges. The rest of the time, who knows? You're just, you know, just making noise. Anyway, Clarence and I don't see eye to eye on that. And he's wrong.
Well, in light of that, there are several questions that go to this. Let me draw this as an example. How common, or contrarywise, how difficult is it to convince another justice off his or her position?
I don't much try to do it. I really don't. All I hope to do is to get my take on the case before the other justice, and there are various ways to do that. You can go around before the conference and sit down in the office, talk it over. That's not very effective. It's not effective for an originalist, okay? The second way is the law clerk grapevine. Your law clerks tell his law clerks what you're thinking, his law clerks tell him. I mean, and I always tell my law clerks, yeah, you know, blab, go, I don't mind. And the third way is during oral argument, where you use the counsel as a shuttlecock. Quack, quack, you know? To show to the other justices, you know, how you're thinking about the case. And you know, if you're not an originalist, if you are a consequentialist, if you think that the Constitution changes, and you know how it ought to change because you've been appointed a judge. If that's your philosophy, you can do a lot more. Bill Brennan could do a lot more, and he used to go around from chambers to chambers. You realize a person with that judicial philosophy can deal. You have stuff to trade. Bill Brennan would say, you know, the Constitution never said this, but I'd like it to say this. I think that'd be a really good idea. And the guy's talking, oh, no, Bill, I can't go that far. So say, well, how about going this far? Now, for an originalist, I can't deal like that. You know, I can stop in and say, you know, I've really studied the background of this thing, and this is what the people thought they were doing when they ratified this provision. And what can I say? Well, I can't go along with that. You know, I say, well, how about halfway? You know, halfway between what it really means and what you'd like it to mean, you know? You have nothing to deal. So maybe other consequentialists can be more effective in going around beforehand, but I don't do it anymore. I haven't found it very effective.
It will not surprise you to know that there are a lot of questions about state constitutions.
State constitutions? Oh, it would surprise me. What do I know about state constitutions?
Well, you're getting a lot of questions, so in fairness, I will again draw one out. The threshold for amending the California Constitution is much lower than the threshold for amending the federal Constitution. More than 500 amendments to the state Constitution, only 27 to the federal Constitution. Do you think that this lower threshold for constitutional amendments makes for a constitutional, quote, mess, unquote?
Well, this is going to be Solomonic. The process of amending the Constitution should not be too easy. But it should not be too hard.
The Goldilocks approach to...
You know, Europeans really don't understand the affection of the American people for our Constitution. They don't understand it because amending Constitution over there in almost all of those countries is a piece of cake. All it takes is an act of the legislature, an intervening election, and then a repetition of that same act of the legislature. That's all it takes. So, you know, the French Code Civil adopted by Napoleon is largely unchanged. But they've gone through, you know, five different constitutions, and they amend constitutions like they change undershirts. It's quite different for us. And frankly, if there was one provision of our Constitution that I would amend, it is the amendment provision. I think it is too hard. I mean, once upon a time, when there were only 13 states, getting a two-thirds, you know, what it takes is a two-thirds vote of each house. Then it goes out to the states. It has to be ratified by three-quarters of the states. And I figured it out once. If you take a bare majority of the citizens in the quarter of the states that are the least populous, something like less than 2% of the population could prevent a constitutional amendment. It shouldn't be that hard, but I'm not willing to have a convention to fix it, I'll tell you that.
And why is that? Why not a constitutional convention?
Oh, my goodness. This is not a good age for adopting or amending constitutions because people have learned, and that's why everybody comes to us to invent new constitutional rights. They have learned that the benefit of getting something in the Constitution is it places it beyond popular control thereafter. Whatever your pet project is, whether it's a right to abortion or a right to this or that, if you can get the Supreme Court to put it in the Constitution, you're golden. It's the law for every state in the Union, cannot be changed by any state. can even be changed by Congress. People have understood, you know, the Brazilian Constitution, adopted something like 15 years ago, has something like 352 articles in it, which include everything, such as severance pay when you're fired, a maximum usury rate, you know, all sorts of stuff. Cram it into the Constitution, and you'll have it forever. And that's what would happen in a constitutional convention. No, I don't mess with it.
Judicial power. One of the dividing points on the current court is standing to sue. And one question has to do with a very recent opinion by the court, an environmental case. In Summers versus Earth Island.
They wrote that.
The dissent. Sorry, I'm just here to ask the questions. Suggested a standing doctrine based upon the mere probability of harm to the members of an organization. How do you feel that the possible appointment of, I'm just reading the question, a liberal justice in the Obama administration may affect standing based on this proposal in light of the fact that this was a 5-4 decision?
Yeah, and I wrote the 5, so obviously don't agree with that with that dissent. Look, what do you think we're doing when we make up standing rules? Are we entirely free to make them up? You think, you know, Scalia, what do you think would be a good idea for standing? Is that what I'm supposed to do? I don't think so. What I'm trying to do when I analyze standing is figure out the meaning of the judicial power in Article 3 of the Constitution, which says the judicial power shall reside in the Supreme Court of the United States in such inferior courts as Congress may ordain. What does the judicial power mean? Is that term self-explanatory? The Indian Supreme Court is operating under a constitution which, like ours, has a Bill of Rights. And the Constitution says that the Supreme Court shall ensure the protection of those individual rights. They have chosen, the Supreme Court of India, they have chosen to interpret that provision to mean that if they're sitting around of a Sunday afternoon reading the Bombay, it's not Bombay anymore, it's Mumbai. I don't change. It's a Bombay Times. They're sitting around reading the Bombay Times, and they find an article which says that the police commissioner in Punjab is arresting people without cause and holding them without hearing. They will, on their own initiative, summon the police commissioner to appear before them and give an account of himself, thereby protecting the rights set forth in the Bill of Rights, the Indian Bill of Rights. Now, is that judicial action? Well, it certainly is. It's the Indian Supreme Court. You understand what I'm saying? The judicial power could mean anything. What did it mean to the framers when they said there's the judicial power, the executive power, the legislative power? What did it mean to the framers? It meant what the judicial power was in the common law in 1789. And what was it? So what I do for standing is look back to see what did you have to do to bring a case in 1789? The court was certainly not a self-starter. It couldn't on its own investigate a matter. There had to be a plaintiff, and the plaintiff had to have a stake in the matter. And that's the end of the question for me. I don't care whether this other approach might be better or not. I don't know that it'll be better. It will certainly reduce the power of the executive, which these people like. These people are concerned with the so-called imperial presidency. Anybody who's been around Washington for any amount of time knows that is, as the framers knew, that it's not the presidency that will be the threat. As the framers knew, it will be the legislature from which oppressive measures proceed, which is why they split it in two to weaken it, which is why they gave the president the veto power to protect himself. So, it'll weaken the president, and if that's what you're after, fine, but you'll live to regret it.
What presidents, speaking of which, of whom, what presidents do you admire most, and have you ever been social friends with any president?
Well, look, I got to say the Gipper. He appointed me, right? He appointed me to the court. He appointed me to the court.
Young people, that's Ronald Reagan.
Yeah, well, what am I, an ingrate? I mean, after all. the great communicator. No, he was a likable fellow there. But I didn't know him that well. I really didn't. And he didn't know me that well either, come to think of it. When we were going out into the White House press room, and it was a big surprise to the press, nobody knew that Berger was stepping down. Rehnquist was going to take Berger's place as chief, and I was going to take Rehnquist's place as an associate justice. So we go out into this snarling reporters in the press room, and as I'm walking out, one of Reagan's aides said, "You know, well, we got him to say Scalia, but I don't know about Antonin." And sure enough, I think he messed it up. I think it was Antoine or something. But the president that I got to know the best, I got to know Jerry Ford very well because I was in the executive branch at that time. I was head of the Office of Legal Counsel. And it was a terrible time for the presidency because, Gerald Ford had never been elected to anything except the congressional district of Grand Rapids, Michigan. And he was just getting mauled by the Congress. But I got to know him quite well. And I got to know very well Bush 1. For some reason, he was very receptive to the court. He invited the court out to Camp David, the whole court, several times. He was a real, real gentleman. Did you mention the flag burning case? You mentioned it something. I was the fifth vote in the flag burning case, which held that the First Amendment forbids making it a crime to burn the American flag so long as it's your own American flag. That's what I think the First Amendment means. Well, When that opinion came out, I didn't write the opinion, I think Bill Brennan did, but I joined it. I got a lot of criticism from the right. I mean, from the guys who I usually expect to be supporting me, and oh God, they were furious. Bush 1 wrote a handwritten note, not to me, he wouldn't have thought that was appropriate, but he wrote it to Maureen. Saying Nino's getting a lot of criticism on this flag issue. Tell him not to worry about it. He did the right thing, George Bush. I mean, that was just a really noble thing to do, the President of the United States to take the time to write my wife a note like that. So I got to know him quite well and respected and admired him a lot.
Another presidential question, and by the way, a number of questions have also asked for, what do you think about the constitutionality of X, Y, or Z? And so I should not ask those questions. Fair to ask, but they're not making it through the filter.
You can ask whatever you like. I just won't answer it.
Well, since you invited me. In his election campaign, but a number of questions. In his election campaign conversation with Pastor Rick Warren, now President Obama said you are a justice that he would like to replace. Any response?
No.
Good.
Justice. That question should be addressed to my doctor.
Justice Scalia. What do you wish someone would have told you when you finished law school and began the practice of law?
Between law school and practicing law.
Mm-hmm.
I wish somebody had told me, you know, before you settle down and decide where you want to practice, get a look at the West Coast. I was, my goodness, I was at OLC. It must have been 20 years out of law school before I came to California for the first time. I went to an event at the Center for the Study of Democratic Institutions, which was in Santa Barbara at the San Ysidro Ranch. And oh, it was Lotus Land. I couldn't believe it. I just took my breath away. Anyway, that's what I was saying to him.
The Supreme Court was often portrayed on the television series Boston Legal. What did you think of their portrayal of you?
You know, I haven't seen it. I want to see it. I understand that I conducted a gay marriage, didn't I?
I didn't see that episode.
Did I conduct a gay marriage in Boston Legal or not? Who? Yeah. See, I did.
Was it legal?
I don't know. I didn't see it.
With regard to the loss of prestige at the federal district level, can some of that, this is in response to the colloquy, can some of it be attributed to judges being seen as rubber stamps because of statutes such as the federal sentencing guidelines, although those are now viewed as advisory?
No, I don't think so. I think it's judges are not regarded as... I think one reason federal courts are losing business, not just that the process is so long and it's expensive, so let's go to arbitration or something, it's also because the practicing lawyer doesn't know these people. It used to be they were the prominent lawyers that they used to practice with in this city. In New York, they came out of White and Case, they came out of Cravath. They were known quantities. These people now, they don't know. These people are increasingly people who, as in Europe, have been judges their whole life, or at least with the executive. They start off as assistant U.S. attorney somewhere, okay? Then they get a job at a minor state court, and then they become a federal magistrate judge, then a bankruptcy judge, and they get promoted right through the system. I'm not saying all these people are incompetent. Some of them are very good, and I'm not saying you can't have some people like that, of course. But to have an entire judiciary like that, and not to have the knights of the bar who used to be the judges in major courts, is a great loss, and that's where we're heading. I don't know that it can be turned around. As I say, the money is one thing, the less prestige than it used to be is something else. We may have seen the best days of the federal courts. It was a wonderful court system. You know, we may have seen the best of it.
The internationalization or globalization of law. What do you see as the emerging role of international law and American constitutional jurisprudence? And is there a concern that constitutional law will be supplanted by international treaties, declarations, or other sources of foreign law?
Well, not unless we sign a treaty. I think the most foolish thing in the world is to do what European countries have done, which is to accede to a treaty which uses vague language, such as right to privacy, okay? And then leaves the interpretation of that language not to your national courts, but to some international tribunal. That's what they did with the Convention on Human Rights, which has exactly that guarantee, right of privacy. And what it means is determined by the court in Strasbourg, which implements that treaty, and they have come up with some really weird opinions, such as England permitted homosexual conduct, but they had a law against indecency, which did criminalize homosexual conduct involving more than two people. So the Bobbies busted some, I mean, it can only be called a homosexual orgy, five men who considered the thing so little private that they were videotaping it, okay? The court in Strasbourg says, this is protected by the right of privacy. I mean, you are nuts if you enter an international treaty that has vague language and leaves its interpretation to some international body. I mean, when the Supreme Court does it to you, at least it's your countrymen. But to have some foreigners doing it, that is really outrageous.
We are a very family-friendly place, so it's not surprising that a number of questions go to family parenting. And so let me put before you a very complimentary question. As the parent of a large and successful clan with a high-profile consuming appointment, what tips can you offer us to be a good parent?
Oh, my. I said at lunch, I don't take credit for the kids. Maureen has devoted her life to that and knows just what the particular needs of each one are and has done a terrific job. I am probably remiss in not... I don't think you have to go to soccer games. My father never went to soccer games. I mean, he said, you know, go out and play. Did I feel bad because he wasn't watching me play? I didn't feel bad at all. So.
You didn't feel neglected?
No, I didn't feel neglected. So that's not essential. What is essential? Be home for dinner. Be home for dinner. That is when the little monsters are civilized. They do not grow up civilized. It is a process, and much of that process occurs at family dinner.
Well, we can say on personal knowledge that his nine children are extraordinary human beings, each very successful in his or her own way. And so staying with the theme in the minute or two that we have, as a fellow conservative Italian American, it is an honor to have you here. You didn't know all these years. Can you speak to the morals and values from your household growing up that have affected your judicial philosophy? There are several questions to that effect, including your faith.
I have never been a professional Italian American. those Italian Americans who went before me undoubtedly plowed the land. I didn't feel, discrimination, which I'm sure they did. Only once did I, and I'm not sure it was, I applied to get into Princeton and you had to have an interview with Princeton alumni, and I was just not a Princeton type, let's face it. I'm not sure if it was Italian-American or New York, one or the other. I'll tell you a story. Why I did not realize... I got confirmed 98-0. And, I thought that's because I was so darn well qualified. Until after the confirmation was completed, I got cartloads of mail. I mean, cartloads. These mail carts are cloth carts with all from Italian Americans who were just popping their buttons with pride because they have this mafioso thing hung around their necks. 99.9% of them are good, hardworking, patriotic Americans, and. Nonetheless, if the name ends in a vowel, and that really gets them mad. Now, you can have an Italian senator, but he can still be a crook. You can have an Italian-American governor, but he can still be a crook, but an Italian-American Supreme Court justice. That was, to them, the symbol of integrity. And I feel a great responsibility not to let them down on that score. But that's why it was 98-0. I mean, you know, Teddy Kennedy from Massachusetts was not about to vote against me. I didn't know it, but he knew it. Howard Metzenbaum from Ohio, you know how many Italian-Americans there are? He was not going to vote against me. And right down the line, Arlen Specter from Pennsylvania, so forth. I didn't realize all that. My wife calls me Mr. Clueless.
Well, Mr. Clueless has written a great book with Brian Garner. Reliable sources tell me there has been a run on the bookstore. We are reordering, so just let the bookstore know or let the dean's office know, and we will make sure that you get your copy of this absolutely wonderful book, written really for everyone. Yes, for law students and lawyers, but it's a book from which everyone can
profit. I tell them who Brian Garner is. It's not just me. Brian and I teamed up on it. And he's the editor of Black's Law Dictionary. He has written books on American Legal Dictionary. He's written books on, big fat books on legal writing and on argumentation. But this is meant to be a quick summary of it. It has some good lines. Let me find the Robert Jackson thing in there.
I always love being a law clerk.
It has little, on some of the pages, it has a little box, a shaded box with a quotation from some famous personage. And when we're talking about, dress appropriately when you come to court, wear a dark suit, and dark doesn't mean dark brown. we had a quote from, here it is, from Robert Jackson, who I told you was my favorite justice. You will not be stopped from arguing if you wear a racetrack suit or sport a rainbow necktie. You will just create a first impression that you have strayed in at the wrong bar.
Ladies and gentlemen, let us thank Justice Antonin Scalia. Brilliant. Wonderful. Oh, beautiful. Just,
thank you.